Hi, I'm Professor Melko, chemistry PhD, and today we're going to talk about states of matter and mixtures. So let's jump into the lecture. Matter is any substance that has mass and occupies volume. Okay. Importantly, in chemistry, we always think about matter as being comprised of atoms, some really tiny unit that is an essential building block towards more complex molecules. If you don't have matter, you call that a vacuum. So vacuum is the absence of any matter. So think of outer space, that's a vacuum. There's no solid liquids or gases and parts of outer space. Of course, then you have things like planets, which are made up of matter. Matter exists in one of three physical states, solid, liquid, and gas. And we're going to learn properties of all three of those states. Starting with solids. And this is something very familiar to us. Solids, the matter is very tightly packed together. Microscopically, if you zoom in, you'll just see a bunch of little spheres representing the atoms, and they're going to come in this nice, neat package design. Okay, they come in some definite fixed shape, so this is, you know, a little cube of matter, perhaps, that is a solid. And if you push on it from certain directions, it doesn't really compress, right? It doesn't really shrink. It's rigid. It has a fixed volume. Now, the reason that the matter is organized as a solid is because it is a low energy state, right? The atoms in here have some energy, but not enough to break apart from one another and slosh around or enter the gas phase. So these are the characteristics of a solid, right? The Iron Throne, the best solid in all of Westeros. Liquids. Matter is more loosely packed than it is in the solid phase. Okay, so now instead of having that really tightly packed solid state, you have a little bit more energy in the atoms and they sort of are loosened up. Okay, you still can't compress it. If you push on a liquid, it doesn't really shrink, it just sort of moves out of the way. The liquid particles freely move past one another, right? There is no definite shape. Before, in a solid, it was this cube, and if I push it over, it stays as a cube, right? But a liquid, if you tilt a container, it sort of conforms to the edges and the sides of said container. More energy than the solid state, but less energy than gases. Some examples: water, of course, the best liquid. Cats must be liquid. Liquids take the shape of the container while maintaining a constant volume. That's it. Cats, liquid. Gases, the third state of matter we'll talk about. Particles of matter are far apart and uniformly spaced. So in this container, instead of all the atoms being closely packed down in the corner, they're sort of all over the place and they have high energy. They're bouncing off the walls of this container and they're sort of dispersed evenly throughout. Okay, the gas expands to fill the entire container. So kind of like a liquid, it conforms to the container. You can compress this. Okay, if I put some motorized attachment on the side that starts pushing this wall in, all the gas starts moving to the left side of the container. Right, so you can compress this state of matter, whereas you cannot compress solids and liquids. Gas molecules have high energy. That's why they are a gas, is because now the atoms have enough energy to leave their neighbors. All these atoms are attracted to their other atoms, right? So there is some intermolecular attraction there. But if they have enough energy, they can overcome those attractions, separate. And so this gas phase is characterized by a high enough energy to separate the atoms apart. So an example of gas, obviously, is, you know, pot of boiling water. You have this liquid. It starts boiling, turning into steam, which is just gas phase water. Usually can't see gases, but here there's some refraction of the light that we can detect. Changes of state, of course, you can go back and forth between solid, liquid, and gas by changing the energy, right? So here's our solid. If you give these atoms enough energy, they will start loosening up. And if you give them even more energy, they'll overcome that attraction entirely and enter the gas phase. So changing the temperature changes the state of the matter. Water, as depicted here as spheres instead of actual molecules, is shown as a solid below 0 degrees Celsius. It would be this solid state. Between 0 and 100 degrees Celsius, you're in this liquid state. Above 100 degrees Celsius, you enter the gas state. Now, this transition between a state of matter, whether it's solid to liquid, or liquid to gas, or solid to gas, all have unique names. Some of them you're probably familiar with. Solid to liquid, melting. Right? We're familiar with an ice cube melting. Liquid to solid, freezing. Liquid to gas, vaporizing. Vaping, of course, draws its name from this characteristic, liquid to gas phase transition. Gas to liquid, condensing. A cold beverage on a very humid, hot day, you see some of the water molecules in the air, the gas, hitting the side of the container and sticking to it and forming these liquid drops, right? That's condensation or condensing. These are pretty familiar to us. Sublimation and deposition, not as familiar, right? But you can have a solid that enters the gas phase directly. Dry ice is one of these compounds. Dry ice is nothing more than carbon dioxide that is subliming at room temperature. It's this cold solid block of CO2 we buy that when put in a warm place like room temperature, it sublimes. It enters the gas phase. It doesn't pass through the liquid phase. That's what makes it dry and not wet. Gas to solid is the opposite of this sublimation process. This is deposition. Okay, so if you trap humid air and cool it down really quickly, you can go directly from the gas phase to the solid phase for those liquid water molecules in the gas phase. So instead of condensation like we had up here of the bubbles, if you immediately get it really, really cold, those gas molecules deposit. And this is sort of what gives rise to this sort of freezer burn, where you've trapped this humid air inside a really cold environment. These ice particles, solid water, is now deposited from the gas phase. So those are various changes of state that we can have. Now, as far as another classification of matter, you can classify it into solid, liquid, gas based on its properties. But you can then mix various solids or various liquids together. And so you can then have these mixtures. And a mixture is composed of more than one substance, but usually that can be physically separated into its components. Okay, so you can maybe filter out one component from another. Okay, a pure substance, though, is composed of only one thing that cannot be physically separated. Okay, so this is the difference between something that's a mixture and something that's pure. And it sounds straightforward, but there's a difference here between physically separating something and chemically separating something. Once we have a mixture, it can be two types. It can be homogeneous or heterogeneous. And homogeneous is something that's uniform throughout. Okay, so think of salt water. You know, one handful of salt water is basically the same as the next handful of salt water. In the same way, one breath of air is similar to another breath of air. Right? There's oxygen in the air, but there's also nitrogen and other gases. And about every breath of air is composed of the same mixture of gases. Doesn't matter if you breathe it here or on the other side of the room, it's still basically composed of the same stuff. Okay, so that's homogeneous. Another type of homogeneous mixture is an alloy. Okay, an alloy is a mixture of two or more metals where that mixture is uniform throughout. So if you have a bronze statue, right, in terms of the elements it's composed of, right, the foot on that bronze statue is composed of the same mixture of elements as the head on that bronze statue. Okay, bronze is this homogeneous mixture of those elements. It is an alloy. Heterogeneous is a lot clumpier, though. There's not uniform properties throughout. Okay, so think of a chocolate chip cookie. Your first bite might have a whole bunch of chocolate chips in it, and some bite later on might have no chocolate chips. Every bite is not the same. It's definitely a mixture because there's dough and chocolate chips, but it's not uniform throughout. Okay, so we have mixtures and pure substances. The mixtures we break down into homogeneous and heterogeneous. The pure substances we break down into elements and compounds. Okay, elements are these essential building blocks. Okay, you can't break it down any further by chemical reaction, right? So gold is just gold. There's no simpler way to break down those atoms into anything different. It's just a gold atom. Right. Other examples, tin, platinum, oxygen. Okay. These are the building blocks of molecules. Compounds possess different properties than the individual elements. So if you take various elements and combine them, you make a compound. Right. But compounds can be chemically separated. Right. So before I mentioned, there's a difference here between physical separation and chemical separation. mixtures, you're physically separating the components. In a compound, you can chemically separate those components into elements. Okay, so an example is water. We know water is H2O. Okay, it's comprised of different elements, right? Combining these individual elements, hydrogen and oxygen, makes our compound water. But if I put in enough energy, I can separate this water out to hydrogen atoms and oxygen atoms into its elements. But that is a chemical process. I can't just filter out the H's and O's separately, but I have to do some chemistry. So that's the real difference here. Okay, so pure substances, we break into elements and compounds. Mixtures, we break into homogeneous and heterogeneous mixtures. Let's get some practice now. You can pause the video here and try to answer this quiz question where we're categorizing these following substances into these four different categories. Try that now. The first one I'm going to try to solve is gold foil. Okay, so just imagine you have a sheet of gold. It is pure gold. There's no way to separate that any further, right? That is just an element. The gold foil goes in the element. It's not comprised of multiple elements. It's not a compound. It's not a mixture of things. It's just an element. Beach sand. Okay, if you grab a handful of beach sand, it's definitely a mixture. There's a lot of different things in it. But every handful you pick up is not the same. So it must be a heterogeneous mixture. Right? The first handful might have a huge shell in it. The next handful might have no shells. Sterling silver. Okay? This is something we need to recognize as an alloy. While silver is an element on the periodic table, sterling silver is a particular type of alloy that's composed of multiple elements. All alloys we're going to classify as homogeneous mixtures. Carbon dioxide. Chemical formula wise, we write this as CO2. It's made up of multiple elements. It's not a mixture, it's just a compound. Vodka. Vodka is a mixture of ethanol, alcohol, water, and some other smaller compounds, right? It's definitely a mixture of various things. This is going to be a homogeneous mixture because the first sip of vodka tastes exactly the same as the last sip of vodka, although you may feel different. Fruit salad, chunky mixture, that's a heterogeneous mixture. All those gross brown banana bits clump up at the bottom. Your last bite is full of banana. Gross. Different from the first bite, full of watermelon. Delicious. Ice. Some students get tripped up on this. Ice is really just water, H2O. That's just a compound. Helium, that's an element on the periodic table. I recognize that as just being an element. So that's how I would categorize these different substances into these four categories. That's going to do it for this lecture. Next time we're going to move on and discuss elements and the periodic table. As always, you can subscribe to this channel on YouTube if you want more videos like this, or come to my Twitch office hours every week where we go over practice problems and discuss science news. That'll do it for today's lecture. Tune into the next one. Otherwise, so long.